Jack, how we doing?
Great.
Good.
So, last week in your matchup against Buffalo Girl, you hung with them for a lot of the game. What do you think the team could have done to maybe put up a couple more touchdowns to win?
Well, you know, I think part of it at this point was our kids played with a great effort. That was good to see. We were excited to see that. We obviously did not have a great week for us, so to see our kids, you know, come back and really play well throughout most of the game was good. It's a good sign going forward for us. I said this after the game, I thought the first half they actually outplayed. They had two plays that they made half of one play. Tim didn't have to take one play, number two. You know, the second run game, we kind of busted a little bit. But it's 14-7 and a half. We're in good shape. We're starting to get a little bit over the top there at the end. So that's something we have to continue to work on to be a little bit more efficient offensively this week. But defensively, I thought we did some really nice things. If we can continue to play with that effort and continue to improve this week, I think that's hopefully a good sign for us.
So the defense was able to force, I think, two or three fumbles in the game. How important was it to try to take advantage of Buffalo Girls' mistakes?
Oh, I think that was huge. You know, if you notice early in the game, we spent a lot of time, obviously, trying to play field position. You know, there was a couple times where maybe we could have gone for it on fourth and two in about the midfield and said, let's put them down there and, you know, trust our defense to continue to give us field position. And they did. You know, I think the problem is we didn't capitalize. We've got to do a better job of capitalizing when we had that opportunity. Blocked field goal doesn't help. But that's one that, it's third and one. We've got to put the ball in the end zone from the 7-yard line. We did not do that. So, part of that's an innate, again, we're a young, inexperienced offense, and we're going to have to be better going forward. So, I think our defense really tried the best they possibly can to help us out. We've got to be better on offense. That's our goal as an offense.
So, what made it kind of difficult to stop their running back, Tommy Tree? You broke out for a couple nice runs against you.
You know, the first run is we actually did a great job defensively. I thought we were in position. We stretched and forced the bounce all the way to the edge. He made one nice move to get to the edge, and then he stiff-armed somebody and put him on their back, and then he had the corner, and once he had the corner, it was done. Zipper captain, he made a great run at that point. The second touchdown run he has, we busted an assignment, which gave him an open seam in the middle of the field. Other than that, he's got, he ends up with about 190 yards rushing, but he only has 50 on 11 carries, and he's got 140 on the other two. So, unfortunately, you have one that he, give him credit, one we bust, and it looks like he had a really nice day, which he did. But for the most part, I thought our defense did a really nice job of keeping that under control. We only had the ball for 16 minutes of the football game. It's just we bent a little bit, but for the most part, we didn't break. We've got to, when we get opportunities as an offense, put the ball in the end zone. Unfortunately, we've got to get better at that point.
So you rotated in another quarterback, Zach Zion, this past week against Buffalo Grove. What went into that decision?
That was the practice week. We felt that it kind of helped to calm Jimmy down a little bit, to kind of take a step back for a series and see what's going on. I think it did help in the first half to do that. Zach earned some time and opportunity with what he had done in the practice week. As the second half moved on, Jimmy was doing some really nice things, so we kind of kept with that pattern. We said going into the game, look, both of you going to play. Zach might play three plays. Zach might play three quarters. It's just going to be looking at what's happening within the game flow. I thought Jimmy did some really nice things. He played his tail off, which you got to love. He's still young and still learning. So I think that's something that it allowed him to take a step back and kind of see the picture that was going on in front of him. And I think he played better because of that. In the second half, we really went away from that plan because Zach had play safety. Jack Hasmer went down. He's our next safety in the football game. So Zach started playing safety, and it was like, okay, let's leave Zach alone and let him play defense and let Jimmy continue to do what he's doing. And he was doing a nice job offensively. So, I don't know what that plan will look like this week. A lot of it might depend on what our defense health looks like. Both kids will practice at it. But I have confidence both kids do the job. They both have done a really nice job, historically, kind of getting ready for the week. So we're looking forward to seeing what both kids can do going forward.
What would you say the turning point in your game against Buffalo Grove was?
I think us not capitalizing on the good field position our defense gave us early in the game, unfortunately. I think that allowed them to stay in the ball game. We were controlling the tempo. And even though they make two runs and we scored maybe 14-7, 7. I think if we put points on the board early, I think it's a very different ballgame. But that's something we've got to continue to learn from, and finish a drive. I mean, that's something we've talked about a lot this year, so we've got work to continue to do. If we can do that, help in a commensurate way our defensive prowess in the first 5 weeks with our offensive team in the world, I think we have the makings of a pretty decent football team. We've got to accelerate at a much faster rate than we're on.
So against Buffalo Grove, the team suffered a couple of injuries, but was still able to hang tough with them. What do you think that says about the depth of this team?
Well, we're not the deepest team, because we, at one point it was like, well, who's in the game offensive line-wise? And we were shuffling the chairs left and right. It says a lot about the type of character of the kids we have. Caleb Smith, who's a sophomore, who's never played a varsity game, is all of a sudden playing against one of the best defensive ends in the area. And doing a decent job. Ty Lusso, who wasn't planning on hopefully playing except in an emergency situation, has to come in and plays. And then has to move to center when Mitch gets dinged up for a series. Jack Heiss had to move around between tackle and guard in different positions. So it's one of those situations where we had a lot of kids jump into positions to help us out. And defensively, we did the same thing. So it's one of those where I think our kids have the right mindset and attitude to continue to work when they get opportunities forward and perform. We're not the deepest team, but we do have great character as a group of kids, and they want to step forward for their teammates. I think it says a lot about the type of kids we have to continue to work going forward and try to play. And look, some of them are having to do that this week. We're going to move Kate Lusser back to the offensive line, playing receiver, to help with our depth, as well as play linebacker, because we're obviously going to be missing a couple of those linebackers.
What were your biggest takeaways from the game against Buffalo Grove?
I was much happier with our effort, with our desire to get better this week. I think we learned from the Highland Park experience that was embarrassing, that we did not really show up to play football game. And it bothered our kids, and they gave away one of nine opportunities. You don't really get nine chances to play a football game that are guaranteed to you. You spend 9 months with no one watching you preparing to give one of them away. It's kind of, it's not natural. It's not something you should do. And I think we realized that was a massive mistake that we made as a team, and that we didn't want to do that again. And I was very proud of the fact that they played with a great effort against a team that's more known, that is clearly more athletically gifted than us. And we held our own for the vast majority of the football game. Now we have to accelerate ourselves to be prepared to actually do it on a short week and try to defend it. We haven't won home this year. I would like to think we've tried to do that this week.
Thank you, Coach Sebastian. Next up, we'll have an interview with receiver Connor Heindel.
Needs to punch it in. We had something like two fumbles, I think, in the red zone. and we had a couple more opportunities. We couldn't punch it in. And with our defense playing the way they're playing, we need to help them out and come through for them.
What will receivers and running backs need to do this week against Metro to get the ball moving?
I'd say we just need to play better together as a unit. Receivers need to block on the edge better. Running backs need to make their one-step cuts, get up in the hole, and that would be huge for your offense. But we just need to work together as a unit and realize what we're seeing and diagnose it.
What have been some points of emphasis this week in practice?
That we need to finish drives again. Our defense has been playing great. We need to keep playing aggressive on defense. We need to finish the play longer than the opponent, play the play, pass the whistle, and just keep working hard. You can't show up on a Thursday and expect to get a play hard Monday through Wednesday.
What is the team's mindset heading into your matchup against Rolling Meadows?
Just to do our job, do what we can do, and hopefully the results will reflect what we've done over the week and how hard we've practiced and focused in.
Stay tuned for a special interview with boys soccer coach Michael Andrews.
Thank you.
Consensus probably among all our players, and I would totally agree, is the game against Glenbrook South early in the season. That was a game where it was the second game of the season. We kept them scoreless in the first half, despite the just onslaught of shots that they were drilling at us. And in the second half, Martin Whitman came through big on a corner kick goal. Beautiful Nico Mo cross. So in the end, I think the takeaway from that game is we can, when we're at our best, we can beat anybody. Glenbrook South is definitely a team where I think we're one of two blemishes on their record. So going into the postseason, that confidence is going to be big for us.
How have you seen the team grow throughout this season?
I just heard Coach Sebastian talk about the character of his team, and I got to tell you, that must be a prospect thing, because we are just a couple weeks from postseason play, and I got a team that's giving me 100% all the time. There are absolutely no egos. So many people told me, as a varsity coach, I'll be dealing with egos, and I can say with certainty I'm absolutely not. If I take a guy like Nico and ask him to play in the midfield, even though he's a forward, he'll do it. If I ask Aaron Whiteman to play defense, even though he typically plays midfield, he'll do it. These guys do what's best for the team, and they give me everything they got all the time, so I really can't ask for more than that.
What do you think the team's biggest goals are for the rest of the season?
Well, we had plenty of preseason goals that had to do with training, but at this point in the season, honestly, just win every game. We show up, capture the momentum early, and we play to win. And I think every game from here on out is winnable.
What has been your main message to the team before games this season?
Well, after the Barrington game, we were down 2-0 for most of the game, and Pat Liminalka scored with about 15 minutes left, and the team completely transformed. There's a surge of energy. We possessed the ball. We came very close to tying the game. And we had a conversation afterward about how momentum is very much just a state of mind. And that's been the thing I'm trying to get them to understand at the beginning of the game. Why do you have to wait until you're down, by a goal or two to play in that, to play that way, play from the beginning? The best players, I think, can capture the momentum at will. And if we can do that from the beginning, instead of waiting until we're up or down three goals, we can do great things.
What matchups are you looking forward to the rest of the season?
All of them. I think tomorrow's going to be a big game. It's senior night tomorrow at our stadium. So, you know, if you guys want to come out and support the 10 seniors that have given so much to the program, that would mean a lot to us. So we play tomorrow against Elk Grove, 6:30 at Prospect. But really, again, every game we play to win, and it's going to be exciting. So.
Thank you, Coach Andrews, and stay tuned for week 6 preview with Jack Ankeny and head coach Mike Sebastian.
Jimmy, I think, had probably his best game of his five games. But at this point, he's only five games into his junior year, so he's still learning on the fly too at this point. So, you know, we're really looking forward to seeing what he can do. Zion, you know, plays in this game a little bit. That's great as well. Zachary's also focused on playing a little bit of safety at this point. You know, we've got Adam Ryerson, who's our JV quarterback, who also is going to be prepared and be ready in the game as an emergency. Go from there. You know, we've talked about, you know, a couple different scenarios. You know, if something happens, you know, you can be ready for. So, you know, it's one of those situations where we'll have all those kids ready to play football and go from there.
What aspects of the game will be crucial to execute in order to take down Roland Meadows?
I think it's the basics. You know, we've got to be better with just simple details. You know, we can't have little mistakes like, on third and one, you know, roll a snap back. You know, can't have that this week. You know, we've got to, you know, make sure we're blocking the right guys. We've got to make sure that we're doing our job in terms of, you know, when we're playing the dive, when we're playing, you know, the stretch route, you know, on defense. You know, do our responsibilities within our team framework. When we do that, I think we'll be in okay shape. Roland Meadows is a good football team. They're highly well coached. They're obviously in the pursuit of, you know, trying to once again, you know, be successful in the East Division. You know, and we're, you know, trying to get ourselves to 1-1 in the East and trying to make, you know, a competitive aspect of what's going forward in that division. So, you know, we both have a lot to play for, and I think that's going to be the focus as we go through the basics so that we can hopefully get ourselves the result we want.
Thank you very much, Coach Sebastian. That'll do it for this segment of CrossFit Football Weekly. Next, we will open it up to the fans for any questions they have for Coach Sebastian. Welcome back, everyone, to Week 6 of CrossFit Football Weekly. We will now take questions from the fans or players. So if anyone has a question, I'll be around the crowd. Just flag me down for any questions you have.
First question.
Hey, Coach Sebastian, how you doing?
I'm doing well.
I'm Stephen Kaiser's dad. How impressed were you with the freshman team on Saturday's game?
You know, I've watched the film a little bit here yesterday late. I thought they did a very nice job. You know, it's good to see, you know, a young group of kids continue to get better. You know, the kids have done a very nice job at the freshman level, starting to learn the game. The staff has done a really nice job. Coach Lusser and his staff have done a wonderful job of getting them prepared. So it was fun to see them put up as many points as they did. You know, the offense is really growing. You know, you see a kid like Gary Moeller, you know, continue to get better. Some of these young guys that are obviously playing at this point, they've got a very nice offensive line. They've moved the ball defensively. I think one thing that I was really impressed with, even when we watched them in their scrimmage, you know, 5-6 weeks ago, was how they moved the ball, and they played very much downhill as a defense. So, you know, I think it's really cool to see how these kids are playing, how they're playing for each other, playing together. And, you know, I'm excited to see, you know, how they finish the rest of this season and then move forward, obviously, in the program. So, no, it's they're doing a really nice job. They have a lot to be proud of.
Anyone else have questions? We're open. That's all right.
Hi, Coach Sebastian. Dave Ice. What do you enjoy most about coaching 17 and 18-year-old athletes? What's the biggest challenge that you experience coaching kids of that age?
You know what, I do enjoy getting a chance to see young men in a position of learning, a position of adversity, and grow, and hopefully take to some of the lessons that we're trying to teach them. And just the character of the kids that we get to deal with, I think is a lot of fun. I enjoy getting to see kids that, you know, maybe aren't the biggest kids in the world, really develop and grow and continue to exceed what might be expected of them when they play the sport. You know, I think what's interesting and probably the most, not difficult, but the thing that can be at times frustrating is that at 16, 17, 18 years old, they're still, you know, learning the game, they're still, you know, developing, and at times, this is not, you know, an issue for one group. This is a teenage thing, but this is also, you know, an experience this year coaching 9 and 10 year olds for baseball. Just being able to focus for the time frame they're expected to focus is difficult, and I get that. So there can be a frustration times because you want them to be a fully formed product by the time they get taken. They're not. So sometimes it's like I got to remember they're they're 16, 17, 18 years old, and they're still learning and developing and growing too. So sometimes pulling back and understanding that and really kind of talking through it. But, you know, they're really good at being able to expect more of themselves because they know that there's a expectation of themselves from the staff and from the team. So I think that's the biggest thing. When you see a group of kids come together from their teammates, that's a lot of fun to watch and how they play for each other. I've been doing this now for 19 years here at this high school. I've spent more time at this high school doing this than pretty much anything else in my life. And to see the character of the young men that we've gotten a chance to work with and how they will do amazing things for each other and how they still have that bond of playing together when they come back 10, 15, 20 years later is very rewarding as an educator. You know, I consider the football field to be just another classroom. So to get to see them kind of develop and do that is a lot of fun. And we're fortunate. You know, we have now four different guys that are on our staff in our football program as players that are now on our staff as coaches. So, you know, I like to think that when, you know, Brett Perlman started here, when we started, you know, when Brett took over 19 years ago, you know, what guys like Mike Capadula, what Frank Mirandola, myself, what Joe Petrica, a lot of guys who came through this program and worked as a staff air chef, you know, brought to these kids, and these kids have, like, you know, the guys like Rob Collins and Scott Winters, Jim Argentine, Danny Keller, now that kind of stuff. They're now bringing to the next generation, and hopefully we have kids that come back and do the same thing with the next set of kids. You know, so to be able to have that continual connection, I think is probably the best part of my job and what I get to see. You know, and, you know, I think the biggest thing that I learned very quickly and what Coach Perlman always talked about and I agree with is that while it might be my name at the top of the list, I'm just a caretaker for the program that these kids have built. And our kids have built our program. I just happen to be the guy that's in charge at this time. You know, so it's about them, it's always been about them, and it will continue to be that. And they take a lot of ownership and pride. I think that's the best part.
Thanks, good luck.
Thank you.
All right, who else has questions for Coach Sebastian?
Short night. It's okay.
Okay, so I guess that should do it for week 6 of Prospect Football Weekly, brought to you by Buffalo Wild Wings and Mount Prospect. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. It's been a great night.